Hey, what's up, everybody? I've got a guest named Paul Kordon. He is a fabulous tech out of Washington, D.C. area. And I just wanted to introduce you guys to him. And if you haven't been on Facebook or some of the forums or anything like that, you'd be definitely impressed about his work. And I just thought he was a fascinating tech. He's definitely a super high-powered retail tech that actually does some crazy work. So, Paul, now, what's your background? How did you get into PDR? And before we talk about your repairs.
To be honest with you, I got in 1999. I had a friend who was working for the company I'm with now, Dent Masters. And I was newly married, as you can probably imagine the motivation that comes with that. And he said, hey, I think you might like this. And I was kind of in a position where I was looking for a career. And I went, that kind of sounds like it could fit me well. So got on board and did, at the time, we did about 4 months of training in-house with the guys in the company. And kind of got on the road and just started pounding the pavement hard, you know. And I did the mobile tech thing for a while. And eventually, you know, kind of worked into name got around there in the retail market, and then in the body shop market as well, and just kind of built on that from there. And that's leaves me where I am today, which is basically a full time retail tech in the Tysons Corner area, which is a suburb of Washington D.C. And just, man, loving hanging out in the shop, meeting new customers every day, and getting to work on all kinds of stuff, especially as a lot of the retail guys know, especially the guys in the retail shops will know, you know, having a shop really kind of allows you to take some time, set things up differently or maybe a little bit more easily than you'd be able to on a lot, and experiment and kind of see, you know, I consider myself a guy who's exploring the outer limits of what PDR can do. And that's actually a lot of fun for me. And it's really rewarding as well, not just financially, but, you know, just to kind of see what can we do with this thing called PDR.
Yeah.
You know, and I really appreciate your comments. You know, I consider myself a good tech. I don't think I'm the best tech out there. There's always somebody that's going to best you, but it's really fun to do for me. So it's definitely a lot about the reward that comes along with getting to see and encourage guys in the PDR market, in the industry, with what kinds of repairs we can pull off, and continually impress the body shops and the dealerships and our customers. It's pretty fun, man.
I mean, right now, I wouldn't even call it paintless PDR. It's more like PCR, you know? It's paintless collision repair. You know, what you're doing and what I attempt to do, and, you know, and Sal and all Kaz, this, I don't know if you ever met this guy named Kaz, but he's an unbelievable guy too. So
I've heard his name. I haven't met him. I look forward to it though.
Yeah, yeah. He's from, where is he? It's some Europe. I forgot the heck name. I just went blank. Lithuania. So anyhow. Oh, okay. But it's, you know, the pushing the boundaries and stuff. Now, what makes you tick, though? I mean, like, what gives you that, you know, what makes you stop and or, like, keep going? I mean, what is there something behind? Because what I do is I act like there's 100 techs behind me waiting to check out my and tear my work down. So that's how I kind of, like, when I leave a dent, how would the other techs judge my work? So that's right. What the conscience I have. So, I mean, what makes you tick?
You know, probably a couple of things. One of the major ones would be exactly what you just described. I'm always thinking that there's another tech out there who's going to be willing to do what I do, which is go into a place and say, hey, listen, if you got something that your tech can't do or won't do, call me up and give me a shot. Let me see what I can do. And, I'm a pretty competitive person in that way where, man, you give me something and you tell me, oh, I don't know if this is fixable. Well, you just threw the gauntlet down and I'm going to figure out how to get through it no matter what.
Yeah.
You know, so that's a major factor. Some of the comments I've made on Facebook with some of the posts are, you know, guys are like, man, why would you push yourself? Why would you try to, you know, fix something like that? Why would you spend 4 or 5 hours on a dent? Well, first of all, because, you know, we get the right money on it, number one. But number two, I often joke that, you know, with 5 kids to feed, you got to make it happen, man. And if that's what's coming in your shop, you got to make money on that.
Yeah.
And how do you make money on a dent like that? Well, you sell it right. You know, you help educate the customer, encourage them as to why your repair would be premier, maybe to a body shop option in some cases. And basically what you do is you sell them what they want, and you have what they want. And in the end, it usually ends with good. Always under promise and over deliver. That's kind of my rule.
Well, Paul, also, yeah. I mean, it's building your future too. I mean, it's down the line. You know, it's going to come down to who's one of the best techs down the line. Who's going to stay in the game? You know, it's not just about, you know, why would you do that even though you can? And see, as long as there's room to cherry pick, okay, that's fine. That's what you want to do. But yeah, you're right. Anything that comes across your path, it's like not leaving money on the table. Is that correct? Is that the way you're thinking?
That's absolutely how I'm thinking. My line of thought on big dent repair is if it's at all possible to make the customer happy with the finished result, and that might be 75% improved, that might be 85% improved, it may be 100% improved in some cases, then why not take the job? Now, that's assuming, I'm always saying that, assuming that we're getting the right money on the job, you know. When it's no longer financially beneficial or profitable, then as a tech, you know, an older tech who's been doing this a while, you know the jobs that aren't going to be financially profitable, and usually pass on those. It's got to make financial sense. So, because we're in the game for the money, for the most part. Not that, you know, we're just money grubbing guys. That's all we care about. But, you know, I believe we do care about the industry. But it's got to make financial sense. So if it's not making financial sense for you in your market, in your scenario, then you're absolutely right. Pass on that thing. Encourage them to go to a body shop. But I don't want to pass on stuff that I think the next guy is going to say, I can do that. And by the way, it's going to be this money, mm-hmm. and it's going to be great money.
Yep.
I can't live with that.
Yeah, I'm the same way. And also the thing too, Paul, it's, look, like I saw you do that BMW. Mm-hmm. Man, I was gung-ho that day. I was like, all right, man, I hope I get a nasty one, man, because it's my turn. Let me go out there. It's right. The motivation, though. You see what I'm saying? Yeah. And people ask me, some of my friend texts here and saying, yeah, why do you do those dents, Mike? Yeah. It's not because I'm doing it, and not always because of the money, okay? It's because I want to see what I can do. What is capable? What are we capable now these days? I know right in 1991, I was barely capable of finishing a ding clean, you know? Now it's, you know, the sky is the limit. And when you set a bar, and the more people like yourselves and like Sal and Kaz and all these great techs out there, and there's a lot of good techs out there, especially on the forums,
right on.
The more they share, I think it sets the bar for everyone else as a standard. Hey, mm-hmm. you know what? It's capable, because if you've seen it done, and especially you showing videos and you pan it and showing all that stuff, it's for real. You know what I mean? It's right. Like, and now it leaves the tech with a taste in their mouth going, when they're working a dent, like, it's not, they don't no longer have that. It's not impossible anymore. It is possible. Let me give it my best shot. And I think right. that's really motivating. And that's another reason why I brought you on here, because I do appreciate that. And I think, you know, even it motivates more people too as well. And I think that's something you didn't mention, but I know it does in a way. And regardless.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think, gosh, when I see pretty slammed work that's being done out there on the forums and in Facebook and stuff, I know I'm encouraged. I'm motivated to first of all know that it's possible. Yeah. Maybe I just didn't give it a good enough try. Maybe I didn't take enough time with it. Maybe I didn't price it right. But it's possible. And now that I know that, I'm going to push myself to the limit on the next one and try to get that one. You know,
yeah.
That's motivating people in the industry is a huge part of it for me. I'm pretty passionate about the industry, specifically about preserving the value of what we do. If not, maybe not even preserving. Maybe we're at the point where really starting to understand, and industry-wide, PDR techs, understanding the value of what we do for our customers and for the industry. A lot of people come into the shop and they like to compare what we do to body shops. And I've been trying to encourage people that, hey, listen, I hear what you're saying. We kind of get the same result as what a body shop does, but it's not the same approach at all. It's a very different thing. And in the day and age where we have Carfax reports and we have guys with paint meters left and right checking out cars on trade-ins and on sales, you know, what we do is actually a value-added service. It's kind of a double whammy value-added service, because not only are we saving original paint on people's cars, we're saving them a lot of time in a conventional repair, and we're also saving them the potential Carfax history report, which really ends up meaning dollars and cents at the end of the day.
Right. They're holding. They're keeping the resale value of the vehicle.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Now, Paul, let's talk about. Now, let's get into some of your repairs.
Yep.
Okay. What are the most, you know, before I, like the BMW, the latest right. one I seen, the Lane's train wreck that you did. What tools do you use? You'd have any special tools that you're using, or is it just the everyday, you know, common PDR Finesse Ultra, you know, blah, blah, blah tools? Anything specific that you're using that is one of your favorites or what?
You know, on that particular repair, I use quite a few different tools, nothing that's out of the ordinary, nothing that you guys probably don't have in your toolkit. Started off with soft tips. You know, had to work, kind of had to break that job up into a couple of different small sections, because you can't, if you look at that dent and you approach it as one big dent, how am I going to do this? Forget it. You're never going to finish it.
Yep.
You know, and there is a lot of that leads us into another subject, which is the mental toughness that it takes to kind of finish a job like that. And patience. But, you know, I'm using the everyday stuff that you guys have. I love the Ultra, you know, double bends with the interchangeable tips for moving a lot of metal. Sometimes, this is a little bit jerry-rigging, but sometimes I'll use, I think it's the Ultra Hail Rod, but I'll use the handle, the little sphere handle. It's a soft rubber handle, and I'll get that sucker in there, and I'll crank on something that I need to move, you know, a lot of metal really quickly. But one of my favorite tools nowadays, and I've seen this going around on some of the forums and stuff, is blending hammers. You know, using chasing hammers and blending hammers to kind of, you know, relieve pressure from certain eyebrows and crowns, so that you can bring the low spots up. And that those are huge for me. I didn't always do that. You know, I kind of did the same hammer handle with the tapper for years and years and years. And finally stepped out and got into the blending world, and that really does make a big difference, especially with larger damage, because there are often times where there are just subtle areas that needed to be blended down to relieve just enough pressure for something else to move into its place. So blending hammers are huge. Not obviously you can't do a dent like that with just blending hammers. That's not going to work.
Yeah.
But a lot of heat. I use a lot of heat on all the dents I do, and between tools and hammers, man, I mean, we're, you know, rocking them out. It's awesome.
Yeah, I find that when I'm using the blending hammer too, some, especially if it's kind of wants the oil can a little bit, I'll put a little pressure on the low and then start tapping around on the outside, just kind of keep it stabilized. It technically, it's an old body man work, you know, technique, but I don't think enough PDR techs understand that.
Right.
But you're right, the blending hammer techniques are really good. Shane Jacks really blew it up in the last year and a half. I know it's been around, but he's really been blowing it up lately, which is a good thing. And that hammer, do you have his new hammer?
Have his new hammer yet, but that's one of the ones on my list.
Super good. Super good. You got to check it out. Paul, did you use any glue pulling on that BMW to break that down?
I did a little bit. In the video, I think I had mentioned that there was a little bit left. We had quoted the customer a 75 to 85% improvement on that. You know, after really encouraging him that he may want to consider a body shop. But in the end, the circumstances were that was the best option for him. So where I ended up really needing the glue was down at the bottom back edge of the wheel well, where it connected to the flat section of the quarter panel that meets up with the bumper. And you guys probably know that you've got the inner wheel well coming together and meeting with the skin of the car, and that section is always very, very tricky. I always tell customers, hey, listen, I don't know what the access is going to be like. You know, we can try to glue pull it, and in some cars that does great, some cars it doesn't. And so those were the areas where I really ended up needing the glue to move the metal, because I couldn't quite get the right angles or the leverage with the tools to do that. And in the end, you know, it wasn't perfect in that section. But for what the customer wanted and, you know, what we had promised, we definitely hit the expectation for him.
Yeah, I mean, some customers, I see a lot of those in those BMWs right there. Oh, but the customer, you can just get behind it and you can feel it and just push it up from the behind, you know.
Right.
I'm sure you get that. But, that's a tough area. That's a real tough area. Now, let's go back to the part that you were talking about. Now, this is something you hit the nail on the head with. What I tell my students, when you look at a big dent like that, I tell them, don't look at it like some big monster. What you got to do is look at the sections of what you understand of that dent. And I tell them, look, that whole panel's a war. Okay. You've got to break it down into small battles, and you got to win one battle at a time so you can continue, and it starts coming together like a puzzle. And I'm sure that's kind of like what you were thinking too. And that's the way I do my big dents. It's the same.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. You know, I think that those big dents are definitely overwhelming. You know, they can be really challenging, a mental challenge where you go, man, I either hope I can do this, right? I think I can do this. And oftentimes I'll start a large dent like that out going, boy, I sure hope I can do what I said I could do, because if I can't, then I'm not making any money. And you know, that's the name of the game. But, you know, you start off with that. I always start off with that question mark. I'm never 100% confident about most of the large stuff. But I'm fairly confident in what I do. I've done it long enough. You know, we have great tools now compared to the old days. And I break it down and I go, you know, when I look at something like that, I go, okay, here's where I know the toughest sections of that dent are going to be. And I also look at it and I go, here's where I know sections of that dent that I need to work on first, because they're going to relieve pressure in other areas to be able to move it. And so it's a little bit of a puzzle piece. I'd imagine if you talk to Sal or Kaz or any of these other guys that do big stuff, they're probably looking at it in a similar fashion, because it's a strange concept. But sometimes I look at it and I go, not only does metal move back out to its shape, but sometimes metal will move across a panel. Okay, you can actually kind of manipulate where the metal's going to go.
Yeah,
you know, and that's where blending comes in really handy. That's where thinking through which sections of the dent you're going to push first comes in handy, because if you relieve the pressure from this corner where it's really jacked and really, you know, deep, it'll start to loosen up some things for you in this other section by a body line or this area where there are three contours converging at the same time. So, you know, I try to give a little thought to how am I going to approach this, but you certainly have to break it up into sections. And the BMW was one. Sorry, that's my phone buzzing there.
No, it's okay.
The BMW was one where, you know, if you guys look at that pretty carefully, that back section by the taillight was hit pretty hard. So I knew that was one area. You have the section down by the wheel well. That was going to be another area. And what may not have translated in the video was there was a very deep, what looked like a crease that was parallel to that line where the quarter and the bumper meet.
Yep.
So I knew that was going to be an area because the metal was stretched. So, you know, you start bringing it down into areas like that, and you just slowly approach it, you know, a little bit at a time. And on that one, you're going from the taillight and working it through there to working it through the wheel well and then glue pulling, and then, you know, just going back and forth and trying to get the whole thing brought back out to its original shape as much as possible.
Well, it's excellent job on that BMW. And we're going to show other shots of what you've been doing lately. And, you know, this is going to be a long interview, Paul, and I apologize. And we're not going super crazy, but I think it's so interesting what you do. I want to thank you for your contribution in the forums and showing, you know, I think you took everyone off surprise. I know you did me. You know, I was like, where the heck did this dent guy come from, this dent? So it's really cool. I think there needs to be more and more guys out there like that. And, you know, and I love the way you break down and you actually mentioned some things that make sense to people. And it's encouraging. So
very cool. Well, I'll tell you what, I got to tell on myself, because up until a few months ago when I started posting, I didn't even know Dent World existed on Facebook.
Yeah, I know.
So, I was a newbie to, you know, all the forums, especially in the Facebook world and Instagram and stuff like that. But the truth is that that's the way of the world now. You know, social media is where it's at. And as soon as I realized what kind of a forum was there, I was like, man, I'll share my stuff with people. And, you know, I'd love to kind of know where I stand. I had no idea. And to be honest with you, Mike, I was really honored to get the invite. And I was thinking to myself, you know, I didn't think I was that good. I just thought probably dent guys are doing this stuff all the time. But what I found out is that it seems as if I'm pushing the limits a little bit. And I say that humbly. I'm pushing limits. I probably do stuff that guys think are crazy. And I've had some of those comments, and that's fair. But again, you know, I'm really motivated. You know, I got mouths to feed, and you know, to be honest with you, a reputation for the company and a reputation for my own self as a technician to uphold, and I love it, man. It's just, it's fun. I love exploring to see what we can do. You know, what are we capable of? Because we are much more valuable, I think, than we realize. You know, as an industry.
Yeah. Well, Paul, I think my daughter's tapping on my shoulder, man. So. Okay, don't worry. See, everybody, this is the real world. This is the real family. This is the real world here.
Right.
This isn't no radio show professional thing here.
A little bit of money, so you better do it.
Yeah. Paul, thanks a lot for your time, man. And hey, where can they find you at? Where can they, where people can, you know, message you or get a hold of you at if they need to?
Yeah, absolutely. Our company website is dentmasters.com. I'm on there. You can click on some of the locations. I'm in there. You can email me through the dentmasters.com website. Look me up on Facebook if you want to, Paul Kordon. I'm sure you'll probably post the text, spelling of the name and all that stuff. Hit me up on Instagram, any of those places. Cool. You'll find me out there in the social media world. But cool.
Well, Paul, thank you very much. Thanks for taking your time on this Saturday. This is when it was we did the interview, and I look forward to seeing you and meeting you one day in person, hopefully at MTE or something.
That'd be cool. That'd be cool. Thanks, Mike. I appreciate it.
Hey, you're welcome, Paul. Thanks, and have a great afternoon and good weekend.
Thanks, buddy.
See ya.
Bye-bye.
Cool, man.